JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's Weekly Market Outlook webinar for the week November the 30th until December the 4th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, Senior Market Analyst here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, this week starts with the OPEC Plus meeting, where major oil producing nations will decide whether to extend the existing production cuts or increase output production. We also have an RBA monetary policy decision on Tuesday, but we don't expect any action. On Tuesday and Wednesday, Fed Chair Powell and Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin will testify before Congress, while on Friday, the US employment data for November are due to be released. So those are the important events on this week's agenda, but let's take things from the beginning. On Monday, as we already said, the main event on the agenda may be the meeting between major OPEC and non-OPEC oil producers known as the OPEC Plus Group. Following the positive developments around the potential coronavirus vaccine, oil prices have decently gained, and it would be interesting to see whether members will be willing to increase output or keep the existing cuts in place. The group had been expected to increase oil production by 2 million barrels per day from January, but according to media chatter, it is now expected to delay those plans for at least 3 months. So what does this mean? What does this mean for oil prices? A three month extension is unlikely to rock the boat, because this is the consensus at the moment, and thus we don't expect any major market reaction. Now, in case the extension is 6 months or more, oil prices are likely to gain because the oil production cuts will stay in place for longer than anticipated. While in case we do get an output increase, like the initial estimate, we may see a setback. Why? Because increasing supply is negative for prices, and at the moment that's not the consensus, although it had been in the recent past. Now, as for Monday's data, the only set worth mentioning is Germany's preliminary CPIs for November. The CPI rate is expected to have ticked up to -0.1% year over year from -0.2%, but the HICP rate is anticipated to have stayed at -0.5%. This is likely to raise speculation that Eurozone's headline print due out on Tuesday may stay relatively steady as well. Now, on Tuesday, during the Asian morning, the RBA announces its monetary policy decision. Last month, this bank cut interest rates to 0.10% from 0.25%, as was widely expected, and decided to extend its government bond buying program by 100 billion Aussies to buy bonds of 5 to 10 years maturity. Governor Lowe said that a negative rate is extremely unlikely, something confirmed by the minutes of that meeting, which also revealed that if more is needed, officials will focus on bond purchases. However, given last time's bold action, we don't expect any further QE expansion at this gathering. We believe that officials are likely to stand pat and wait for more data to come in before they decide whether more is needed or not. That said, we will dig into the statement to see how willing they are to expand their stimulative efforts if Australia's economic outlook suggests so. Now, from the Eurozone, we get the preliminary inflation data for November. The headline CPI rate is forecast to have ticked up to -0.2% from -0.3%, while the HICP, excluding energy and food, print is expected to have stayed unchanged at 0.4%. At its latest meeting, the ECB noted that in December, the new macroeconomic projections will allow a thorough reassessment of the economic outlook and that the Governing Council will recalibrate its instruments as appropriate. In other words, the ECB is very likely to expand its stimulative efforts at the upcoming gathering and subdued inflation metrics will only add to that likelihood. We have negative headline inflation and subdued underlying core metrics, which are well below the ECB's objective of below but close to 2%, and thus more action by the ECB in December is very likely. Later in the day, Fed Chair Powell and Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin are expected to testify before Congress. They will appear before the Senate Banking Committee on Tuesday, while on Wednesday, they will appear before the House of Financial Services Committee. They will testify on the CARES Act, under which Congress made $2 trillion available to the Treasury as a coronavirus aid, a large portion of which was aimed to support the FOMC's lending programs. Less than a couple of weeks ago, Mnuchin cut off the programs, requesting the Fed to return unused funds and declined any extension. So with all that in mind, it will be interesting to see what the two officials have to say on the matter and whether Powell will hint at other ways in stimulating the US economy from a monetary policy front. Now, in Canada, the nation's GDP data for September and the third quarter are due to be released. Following a tumble to -38.7%, the quarter-over-quarter annualized rate is forecast to have rebounded to 47%, though the month-over-month rate for September is anticipated to have slid to 0.9% from 1.2%. At its latest meeting, the Bank of Canada kept interest rates unchanged and scaled back its QE program, noting that the economic outlook has evolved largely as anticipated in the July monetary policy report. Thus, following the acceleration in Canada's CPIs for October, a small slide in September's GDP and a relatively decent employment report for November, due out on Friday, are unlikely to raise speculation for Bank of Canada officials reversing their decision at the upcoming gathering, namely expanding their QE purchases. From the US, the most important item on the agenda may be the ISM manufacturing PMI for November, which is expected to have slid to 57.9 from 59.3. Now, on Wednesday, Asian trading, Australia's GDP for the third quarter is due to be released. In quarter-over-quarter terms, economic output is expected to have rebounded 2.5% after tumbling 7% in the second quarter, something that would take the year-over-year rate higher to -4.5% from -6.3%. I don't think that this will be so determinant with regards to RBA's future plans, because we will already have a decision on Tuesday, with the next one scheduled for January. So officials will prefer to wait for more data to come in before they decide to act or not at the January meeting. Now, in the US, besides the second round of Powell's and Mnuchin's testimony, we also have the ADP employment report for November. The private sector is forecast to have gained 400,000 jobs after adding 365,000 in October. This could raise speculation that the NFP print due out on Friday may also exceed October's number, which was at 638,000. That said, as we noted several times in the past, the ADP print is far from a reliable predictor of where the NFPs may come in. Even last month, when the ADP slowed to around half, to 365K from 749K, NFP stayed close to their September figure. They came in at 638K versus the prior print, which was at 672K. Now, Thursday appears to be a relatively light day with the most noteworthy releases on the schedule being Eurozone's retail sales for October and in the US, the ISM non-manufacturing PMI for November. Eurozone's retail sales are forecast to have rebounded 0.8% month over month after falling 2%, while the ISM index is anticipated to have slid somewhat to 56 from 56.6. Now on Friday, during the Asian trading, Australia's retail sales for October are due to be released. On a month-over-month basis, they are expected to have rebounded to 1.6% after sliding 1.1%, something which combined with a potential rebound in economic activity for the third quarter may allow RBA policymakers to stay sidelined for a while longer. Now, later in the day, the main release may be the official US employment report for November. Non-farm payrolls are expected to have slowed to 500,000 from 638,000 in October, while the unemployment rate is expected to have ticked down to 6.8% from 6.9%. As for wages, average hourly earnings are anticipated to have slowed to 4.2% year over year from 4.5%. In our view, this is a relatively decent data set, but with the US government and Congress failing to reach consensus over coronavirus fiscal aid, it is unlikely to drastically reduce chances for the Fed to step up its stimulus efforts at some point in the not too distant future. Canada's employment report for November is also due to be released. The unemployment rate is forecast to have held steady at 8.9%, while the net change in employment is forecast to show that the economy has gained 27,500 jobs, less than October's 83,600. Although a somewhat softer than previously report, as we already noted, it is unlikely to raise speculation for Bank of Canada expanding their stimulative efforts again, especially after scaling back their QE purchases at their prior gathering. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great week, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next Monday. If you are interested in more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 8:30 a.m. GMT. So goodbye, have a nice day, and see you soon.
JFT, just fair and direct.